political education, started having conversations with as many grassroots organizations in the Bay Area that we could. And we had a conversation with probably about 30 of them. And what was really interesting is that our primary concern is what sort of political education was going to make people's campaigns and projects and organizations be in the best fighting form and being able to hold ground, if not gain some ground, in this particularly perilous period. Along with what we assumed would be people's needs around defeating Trump and, you know, defending education and healthcare and so on, nearly every single organization we talked to, independently of one another, said it would be helpful for their organizations, their members, their staff to read Black Reconstruction, a book at this point that's about 85 years old. So that was interesting. We're like, the whole thing? They're like, yeah, the whole thing. So we said, okay. And so we said, we're going to do this class, and we put out an application form, and we figured a couple of handfuls of people might sign up, and we'd have a nice intimate little study group. We had 75 people sign up. We turned away 25 of them. We had 50 people in this, met every 2 weeks, and about 40 of them made it through the entire book. And we were honored to think together with all these great organizers and activists about the themes, the critical themes, the critical history, and the critical relevance of Du Bois' ideas, and the ideas and struggles and sacrifices of the people that he was writing about. So we jumped at the chance today to continue along some of these critical themes of Du Bois' Black Reconstruction, those being education, labor, political power, business and oppression, and there's one more, land. Sorry, it's been a long day so far. So today what we want to do is take the opportunity to dig in a little bit around labor. We wanted to try to go back to the text as much as we could today, so I want to start out with a quick quote from Du Bois. So Du Bois, and this is him writing in 1935, he says, "Here is the real modern labor problem. Here is the kernel of the problem of religion and democracy. It is the kernel of the problem of religion and democracy, of humanity. Words and futile gestures avail nothing. Out of the exploitation of the dark proletariat comes the surplus value built from human beasts which, it, in cultured lands, the machine and harness power veil and conceal. The emancipation of, he says, man, the emancipation of man, of people, is the emancipation of labor. And the emancipation of labor is the freeing of that basic majority of workers who are yellow, brown, and black." I want to welcome today our panelists. Dave's going to make a short presentation, and then we'll have some discussion. So we're happy to welcome Melissa Birch. Is an anthropologist whose work is directed towards the intersections of race, class, and gender with criminalization and punishment. Her current research explores how employers consider criminal records in the hiring process. Melissa has also organized and worked with organizations such as Critical Resistance and New Way of Life. Welcome. We have Danielle Mohammed. Danielle is a labor education specialist at UC Berkeley Labor Center, where she provides technical assistance to the National Black Workers Center project. She has also led and worked with the Center for Third World Organizing, the Black Organizing Project, and Black Organizing for Leadership and Dignity. Danielle also spent a long time working within the labor movement. Finally, we have Seba Wahid. Seba is a research director at UCLA Labor Center and co-author of the report Ready to Work, Uprooting Inequality, Black Workers in California, of which there are copies available. This should be enough for most everyone here if you want to take one on your way out. With her team at UCLA Labor Center, Seba coordinated the first ever study of domestic work employers, launched a study of young people in the service economy, and conducted research on the taxi industry. She has also conducted research in other industries such as garment, nail salon, construction, and restaurant industries. Previously, she was research director at the data center. She's also award-winning radio producer. So please welcome our panelists. So what we're going to do is start out with Seba, and she's going to talk a little bit about the report that was released just earlier this year.
Aaron, great. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here. All the panels have been kind of mind-blowing, actually, so we're very humbled and intimidated now. And yes, please take the reports because they were heavy. I don't want to carry them back home. So I'm with the UCLA Labor Center, and this project started because it was about a year or two ago. I was talking to the kind of founder and interim director at the LA Black Worker Center, who was basically saying with what they're seeing in South LA where they're organizing is that the black community is shrinking. They were just hearing stories of people leaving. They felt like they were going to neighborhood counties like San Bernardino and Riverside, where there is much more affordable housing and cost, but that this was really impacting kind of the black community in LA. So we're like, let's look at the data. And so that's how this report came out. You're going to move it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Am I moving?
So this was a collaboration with the LA Black Worker Center and the Labor Center, and as well as the institute that houses all of us. And so we began first looking at, you know, the story of Black Angelenos, and it, you know, going back to the previous century. You know, one was that they've been there, that some of the founding city founders were actually Black, and saying just kind of how there's this history of a strong Black presence in LA. But then, especially in the 1900s, seeing this great migration happening from the South, largely due to the manufacturing industry and, trying to escape Jim Crow laws in the South, but also changing policies that was giving more access to families and workers in LA. And so, you know, there you had access to, eventually access to unions and middle-class jobs and decent quality jobs. Then you see the reverse happen. And, you know, you kind of see the three D's that we've all kind of, you know, heard about, like the deindustrialization, the deregulation, and the deunionization. And the black community gets hit really hard by that because those were the kinds of jobs that they were in. And, you know, like I think about how, like, Trump talks about, like, coal mine workers, is that you could put that story to black workers in urban cities in the ways that the South LA got completely disinvested in, and these jobs went to neighboring areas, they became inaccessible, and then you kind of see the impact of that disinvestment. So the black community in LA since the 1980s has shrunk from what was 12, it's actually one more point on the slide before, shrunk from 13% to 8% at the same time that the LA population increased by 35%. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, there's still a core part of the Los Angeles fabric. They make a third of the entire state population. And so, you know, the LA Black Worker Center really wanted to think about what can we do to counter kind of what's been happening over the last, like what can we do to reverse some of this? So looking at the data, you know, so what's kind of causing this, you know, what they were calling like the black jobs crisis. And, you know, the first thing was like, let's look at educational attainment for black workers. And you saw that they were actually more educated in the last three decades than they've ever been. And yet, at the same time, they still face the highest unemployment of any other community and face twice the unemployment of compared to white workers. You see them in low-wage jobs, so a third of black workers are still in low-wage jobs. And then you see them earning less. So we know about the wage gap, you know, a lot of times you hear them around gender, but you see how black workers make about two-thirds of what white male workers are doing, and then black women workers make even less than white, when black women workers make even less than white women workers, and definitely less than white male workers, pretty much at the bottom of the rung. And then being locked out of key sectors, and you know, some of these sectors are kind of give access to black workers on both ends, those that may have kind of, you know, just a high school education and be able to get into construction jobs, which often end up being kind of ladders to middle income jobs, and then professional jobs on the other side, and seeing that they are basically not, like, are underrepresented in those areas. And same with job positions, so seeing a lot of underrepresentation within the kind of the career ladder, so not being in kind of manager and professional positions compared to their white workers. And then different ways of kind of measuring underemployment. You know, even black workers with a college education still working in a low-wage job, or black workers working in frontline jobs, which are those more entry-level low-wage jobs. So then that, of course, translates into the impact of black wealth. So black workers still have, disproportionate less wealth than white households, and, you know, have less household income than white workers, and all households, actually. And so, you know, we also kind of looked at some of the literature around it, like what are some of the barriers. We'll hear about, like, the criminal injustice system and how that plays out, too. And we also looked at some other kind of, I think you go back there, some other kind of spaces in terms of, like, what are kind of job discrimination things that are happening that are locking black workers out of work. You know, whether it is if you're unemployed for a period of time, it's really hard to get back into the market, you know, the framework of, like, you know, black workers versus immigrant workers and who's hardworking, or, you know, all the kind of different match career studies that I've done where you send people with similar resumes and the ones with black sounding names don't get a call back compared to other workers. And so all of this has also, you know, been documented in terms of some of the structural and implicit bias that happens that are keeping black workers out of jobs. And then there's this connection, so it impacts neighborhoods, it impacts families in the way that, you know, racism actually has a negative health impact on communities. And so the LA Black Workers Center has an agenda, and these are some of their recommendations, and able to kind of counter the data and counter this black jobs crisis. And the first thing was, you know, a lot of discrimination law happens on the state level. So we have a state agency that addresses it, or on the federal level. And you see, kind of, especially on the federal level, like complete disinvestment in kind of civil rights. So they already know it's not going to happen there. And, you know, state agencies are underfunded, so it's really hard to get them into some of the local efforts. So their idea was to create local enforcement of discrimination. And so what they wanted to do was basically take away the preemption that doesn't allow cities or counties to address their discrimination. So if you could do that, then you can have your local office be the one who comes in and comes back and addresses the discrimination complaints versus having to go to the state or waiting for some kind of federal response, which they felt like took too long, didn't have enough funding, and then you could have these city agencies partner with groups like the LA Black Workers Center and other organizations who have kind of direct relationships with workers. So have them be the ones who do those intakes and bring these cases and are able to address them quicker and with more trust, which is often hard in some of these cases. So that was one of the main things, and there was actually a bill, which I can talk about more later, that was introduced, and there's some movement that's happening around that in terms of creating an advisory committee that'll look at the feasibility of that. And then a couple of other things that they said was, you know, basically just, of course, support worker organizing, especially as we're facing more and more kind of right-to-work laws, which is trying to curb union activity or worker organizing, so addressing that and then really thinking of ways of how we can keep building up black worker organizing. And then the last two, so creating policies and programs to increase access for jobs. So let's figure out, like, the jobs are out there, and then how can we do, targeted hiring kinds of programs, local hiring programs that will get black people into those jobs. And then the next one, looking at high-growth businesses. So how can you connect contracting of public agencies to, you can apply for federal funding or state funding or city funding if you have some kind of discrimination on your books, or like putting some kind of accountability measure that'll encourage and incentivize people to not discriminate and then actually get the funds or get the jobs. So that's kind of the end. That's the hashtag they've been using for their campaign. So this is the LA Black Worker campaign. So that's the work. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. You want to talk about
it? Yes, I do. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me, Rachel and Isaac, fellow panelists. It's really great to be in this space today. I started thinking kind of deeply about criminal records as a key mechanism of labor market exclusion and regulation during the years that I spent working with the New Way of Life Reentry Project in LA, as Isaac mentioned, where we established a legal clinic that helped people who were facing job market discrimination based on their criminal records, help them to fight those cases. And we were also key leaders in the Ban the Box campaigns in Los Angeles with the city and county, which, you know, now this is, of course, passed in 129 cities and counties. You know, now it's a huge thing. But at the time, this was a very difficult campaign, and we weren't winning at all. And so the research project that I developed when I decided to go to grad school kind of came out directly out of the challenges and frustrations of trying to make progress on this issue on the ground. So I tried to design a study that would ask the question, you know, what will it take to kind of shift this issue by looking at employers and trying to better understand how they actually are considering criminal records in the hiring process, like on the ground in everyday contexts. And so I spent a year in the Inland Empire, where lots of people live, who have criminal records and are looking for work, and I followed people who had recent felony convictions who were applying for jobs, and then I also spent as much time as I could with employers in their settings and observing their hiring processes directly. So I'm just going to make three points that I want to make. I hope that they're not too elementary for this audience. The first is just kind of the important role that criminal records now play, both as a mechanism of exclusion and also in kind of producing this class of workers who are forced to accept the conditions of the work and who are forced into the worst jobs and meant to be happy to have any job at all, and the role that that plays in undermining all of the rest of what we're trying to do. So by some estimates, as many as 65 million people have a criminal record. I think that number is a little bit high, but, you know, 2 million people in prison, then the 7 million under correctional supervision, and then beyond that, the millions of people who have this lifelong criminal record that restricts all kinds of things about what they can and cannot do and are not eligible for, and, of course, what kinds of jobs they can and cannot get is, you know, just one aspect of that. In terms of how employers are using, it's hard to get estimates that I feel comfortable with of like how many employers are actually using criminal records, but it's definitely the majority, and particularly for large employers, some people estimate that between 60 and 70% of major employers now conduct a background check, like for routine positions, whereas, and I think it's important to emphasize that this is pretty new, actually. This is just like in the last 40 years or so, it used to be that a criminal background check was reserved for kind of positions that were considered sensitive, people doing policing or working with children. Now this is like, so when I'm saying 60 to 70%, that's like as a matter of routine for every single position, for every single promotion or change to a new department, et cetera. There's kind of a, there are some studies that try to estimate kind of how many employers are willing to hire people with criminal records. And again, you know, that's, I'll tell you some of that, but basically it's not good. I mean, there's kind of a large, maybe 40% who say, well, it depends on the crime, which basically means if you have a serious felony conviction, you're not getting hired. But only about 20% of employers in any of these kinds of surveys say that they would hire someone who has a criminal record. So that's kind of point number one, is just that this is a big and growing issue with far-reaching implications for all of us. And the second is, in terms of Black people, the idea that Black people are not only disproportionately, because of our disproportion in the criminal punishment system, not only disproportionately affected by criminal records discrimination, but also more severely and also differently. So the most famous study about how race intersects with the criminal record is by this sociologist, Eva Petra. I don't know if people are familiar with her book, Mark. But she does like one of these tester studies where you send out applicants who are equally qualified in terms of education and experience and gets them to apply for jobs. Some of them are Black, some of them are white, some have criminal records, some don't. And then she measures kind of the rate of positive response to the applications. And what she finds is that to have a criminal record has a way stronger negative effect for Black people than it does for whites. And also she just finds that racism is so prevalent in the job market still that, you know, even white people who have criminal records get hired at higher rates than Blacks who don't. That's kind of, you know, that's another issue. But another part of her study that doesn't get talked about that much that I think is important is that she also measured the impact of having face-to-face contact with a hiring manager. And this is kind of the logic of ban the box, right, which I'm sure people are familiar with, where the idea that if you have a face-to-face conversation with an employer, then that will increase your chances of getting the job. So she found that for white people with criminal records, this absolutely this helps. And that for Black people without criminal records, it was even more helpful to get that face-to-face contact. But for Black folks who had a criminal record, it made absolutely no difference to meet in person with the hiring manager. And she theorizes, of course, that, you know, employers just can't overcome kind of this double stigma of Blackness plus criminality. But here's the thing, and then I kind of get to my third point, which is that criminal records discrimination, I think it's important that we think of it as much deeper and further reaching than just individual bias at the level of the employer. So, right, I mean, even if you could somehow, which we can't, but even if we could somehow eliminate employers' biases about race and kind of their assumptions about criminality, criminal records screening would first of all still be racial because it can't avoid the racial disproportion that's already embedded in policing and sentencing and imprisonment. And so that means that kind of whether it intends to or not, the screening for criminal records does act as a mechanism of racial stratification. But the other thing is just that, you know, and this is something that that came up for me a lot, was very important in my research, was realizing that even though the attitudes of individual employers certainly play an important role in discrimination, the demand for the criminal background checks is oftentimes coming from outside of the employers themselves. So the biggest driver, of course, being the state. The state and federal governments, which have enacted literally tens of thousands of statutes that restrict people's ability to do certain kinds of work, right? So to work in certain industries, to play certain roles, to work under government contracts. So in many cases, in my research, you know, I found that employers were absolutely willing to hire someone with a criminal record, but were restricted from doing so by these statutes. The state also plays like the very important role of making this data accessible through deliberate decisions to open up what used to be confidential police and FBI data, right, and selling it to commercial vendors. And they sell it to a multi-billion-dollar background screening industry that's organized through a bunch of professional associations. And I definitely don't mean to imply that this is mainly a profit problem, but those organizations do now play an important role in Washington in kind of squashing any meaningful discussion that we might have about how public and accessible all of this data should be. There's also a partnering between background screening firms and employment law attorneys with human resource training firms. So they do, you know, all these workshops and webinars kind of training employers in the best practices of how to use your criminal background check, and really promoting this idea that doing a background check all the time for every position is the way to do hiring. And I think that, and I, again, going back to the state, I mean, the statutes themselves are a major problem and that I think we need to focus on, but also just by, I find the state responsible here because by requiring, by increasing the number of positions for which a background check is required by the state, that's how we kind of get into this mess of it's easier to just, then it becomes common sense that we should just do this for all the positions, right? So yeah, I think I'll just stop there and can, I would love to talk more about like what people are doing to challenge this. But
thank you.
So I wanted to talk just a little bit about the work that we've been doing in Oakland and Alameda County. One quick information. So primarily my work is actually with the Bay Area Workforce Center, and not with the National, but that's not your fault. It's because we're the center has a weird bio up on the website, so that
happens
everywhere I go. So I just wanted to first, for point of clarification, speak to the work of the Bay Area Black Workers Center, which is absolutely fantastic organizing. But why this work, right? So I had done labor organizing and community organizing and then became much more intentional about wanting to focus at least my energy and time on Black organizing for Katrina. That was my, you know, everybody has whatever generation you're in, you have your thing, your moment where like everything changed after that, right? And that was the moment for me where I understood that as much as I still believe in multiracial organizing, given what I had just witnessed, I wanted to actually figure out how we're going to do something different for Black folks in this country. And then fast forward, we had the opportunity to work with the Berkeley Labor Center and Stephen Pitts, who also did a lot of work with Lola down at the LA Black Worker Center, which talked about wanting to start an organization. So in 2013, we started to figure out, could we, you know, start a Bay Area Black Worker Center? What would that look like, and why would we do it, and would people even care, and why? So we started with the people, right? We started doing outreach. We started talking to folks, and we wanted to know, for Black workers, what's your experience been with work, right? What challenges have you faced? What barriers or obstacles, and also what successes? And then we moved from that to like meetings and listening sessions and collectivizing those experiences because there were many common themes. And what we found really quickly was this preponderance of low wage work. So people saying, you know, there used to be good jobs, but I can't seem to find one, right? And some of our outreach, I remember going to job fairs where I expected to find unemployed people, right? Because it's a job fair. But the Black people I would find at the job fair were actually trying to find one good job because right now I have two bad jobs, right? And I don't have benefits and I'm struggling. A lot of what I heard was I can't get hired because of my record. And so more and more and more we kept hearing about this criminal record issue. And again, I feel like if you're doing organizing with Black people on whatever issue, if it's employment, if it's housing, if it's education, at some point this issue of how our over-participation in the criminal justice system is impacting our lives is going to come up. And so we started to understand, even though we didn't start the organization to be, you know, like, okay, let's take on criminal justice, but we started to understand that this is a real barrier that was a big part of the reason that our folks are being excluded from good jobs. So then we started doing some work around Prop 47, because that was happening. It was this opportunity for folks to reclassify. You know, and again, because I'm not really a criminal justice, like that's not my lane, we're like, okay, great, this is a great opportunity, and we're going to be able to remove barriers for folks, and woohoo, let's do it, right? And so it passed, it was a big success, and then again, because we're organizing and we're trying to connect with the actual people who would be impacted, we are out in Oakland talking to people, knocking door to door, and have you heard about Prop 47? People's eyes would light up, when they heard felony to misdemeanor, awesome, super exciting. Then you look at the 9 possible felonies, and guess whose felonies aren't there. So for us in Alameda County, and not to knock 47, it is a good thing. And in certain counties, LA in particular, laws and ways were just sending people up for resources. But unfortunately for us, those were not the felonies that were hampering their ability to get a good job, right? So we were like, okay, maybe we need another kind of campaign because this wasn't quite, this isn't totally it. What could we do? So the 47 was put us in a relationship with a bunch of other community organizations doing great work, a lot of whom are doing a lot of good work around criminal justice reform. And so we started working with them. And together we created this coalition called the Justice Reinvestment Coalition that really is about, like, how do we stop public sector policies that are, like, over-investing in punitive lock-em-up strategies and how to actually invest in high-quality jobs and education, things that actually would be useful. And as part of that work, we decided we wanted to push for some type of jobs campaign. And we decided that Alameda County, as a large employer in our region, would be a good target because they employ 9,600 people. It's a diversity of types of jobs. Knowing that the public sector has been, for Black families for generations, one of our tickets out of poverty, right? So, and why is that? Because they're union jobs, to be clear,
right,
with good benefits. So you could be a custodian today at the Port of Oakland and be earning $60,000 a year, or you could be a janitor for a private sector contractor and maybe earning $27,000 a year. It's a huge difference, right? So we thought if we could get folks with felony convictions into public sector good paying jobs, that would be a much better path forward. And we also wanted to figure out how could we get our county, they had already done down the box. However, in our county, their hiring practices, I was looking about, like, could I apply for a county job? I have a BA, okay? I've got 20 years work experience running organizations. And it's, like, a lot. There's a lot of things you've got to do that just make it onerous. Right? Like, you can't just upload your resume. Something simple like that, right? You can't just do that. Not for county. You gotta go in, you gotta know all the days, you gotta put in all this stuff, right? So there's all these things that just make it impossible before you even get to the background check. But what we wanted to do was say, okay, county, we've invested over the years in a lot of training programs, because I think that's another narrative about why Black people can't get good jobs, because we don't know how to do anything, and if we just had some skills, maybe we could figure out how to support our families. Not that there's this, like, proliferation of bad jobs out there. And then you've got the background check, the situation, all these things. So what we said to the county is, like, look, you've been investing in these training programs, but the training programs are not, it's like a bridge to nowhere. So we'd also be talking to people in the community, and medical assistant certification, and I've got my this certification, I've got my that certification, I went to this thing. I don't have a job. Can you help me get a job? Right? So we said to the county, listen, what we need from you is to actually create a hiring program. This is not about training of the people. This is about, will you hire them? And will you affirmatively say that we, as a large employer, will hire you with a felony conviction? And then will you actually hire them? And so we pushed, it was called the 1400 Jobs Campaign because, anyway, I won't get into that. It has to do with, like, a decrease in jail beds at Santa Rita. There was 1400 less people in jail. So we're like, okay, fine, you're not paying for that anymore. How about 1400 jobs, right? That's how organizers do. We don't do all that. My statistic is, she won't say it, she's actually, like, for real, a researcher. What I understand is that 90% of employers do background checks. And I will say it to any board of supervisor and explain to them why this is a big deal, right? We worked with the county. We also got them, we also knowing that there's all these processes, and how can we give this population an edge? How can we actually not just, okay, yeah, you did ban the box, and now you're in this pool of this treacherous waters of this already complicated thing. How could we do something more than that? So we actually got them to create a new job classification where, guess what, the minimum qualification is, number one, you've got a felony conviction. So there's an edge. I'm not competing against anybody but other folks like me, right? And so that's what we did. We also wanted to make sure that people would have access, when he's stuck, right? Like they have like temporary programs or they're like a temp worker. We're like, no, we want these folks to be in the union. We want them to have access to like get out of that class and into the real class, and we want supports for folks. So we're still working on some of like the green, some of the supports starting up right there. They have started hiring folks, which is great. But that's just a little, but that's just a little snapshot of work that we're doing, trying to, and again, because our members were like, well, how do we come with a campaign that could kind of be an intersection around removing barriers for folks, but also not letting go of people need to get hired and people need good jobs. And so that's what we try to do.
Thank you. I wish we had a lot more time to dig in. I guess one of the first questions that comes to mind is, and I said that you pointed this out, is that the terrain is arduous for workers in general, for black workers in particular, given the like to work stuff, the heavy, precarious at best, workers' rights or health regulations. So I'm curious, I think y'all illustrated the rocky terrain. I'm curious, amidst that terrain, what sort of, I'm kind of pivoting off the recommendations you made, because I support worker organizing, but it seems to me that the worker organizing has to have support also from not just unions, for example, but it has to have support from allies, union sectors. So I'm curious if any of you want to talk about some of that alliance building that's happening, or if Daniel Murphy continues to talk about it, that is rather hopeful in these somewhat terrible times.
I can speak a little bit, so I can say that, for example, with the 14-minute jobs, when I first reached out to one of the major unions, who these folks, would be part of their bargaining unit, right? And a lot to what you spoke to. So this sort of idea that they have to be background checking, it's not just employers. This is like seeped out into like everybody moves this way, right? Even union representatives. Right, so I'm calling, this person who I know good on a lot of stuff, and as soon as I said what it was we were doing, he was like, "Well, I don't think that's possible. I don't think you can do that." And I said, "Well, what? Why not?" Well, because he immediately went, "Well, identity fraud," and I'm like, first of all, what made you even go there?" Right? It's just like so. That was a lot, right? And there was like fear around, well, what are our members going to think, because maybe they're not going to feel comfortable working next to somebody and they're going to be scared. And it was like all these biases, right? And then it was over time, I think part of what has been awesome has been the conversations that have been possible. And so what I've seen is now actually union staff and union leaders who actually have the conversations with their members come to find out their members have people who are formerly incarcerated and want them to get a job at the county, right? So it was like actually this big scary thing that they thought it was going to be so treacherous and it was going to be so divisive, and it was actually members saying, no, this is important. I've got my cousin can't get a job. Let's do this, right? So it kind of helped create an opportunity for folks to actually have conversations rather than just assume that it was going to be too hard or too scary or that people weren't going to be for it. So, and by the time we got to the point in the campaign where we really needed them, like, they were there, you know, and they've been there. And I think now there are other unions who are going further and saying, yeah, we want to really, we understand that black workers have been excluded. We understand that there's hiring practices that we normally don't even bargain over. But we're actually interested in figuring out how could we bargain some contract language? What would be helpful? Like, what, right? So there's, I feel like in the work that, has predated, you know, all of the work that led to, like, banning the box and all of that great work, even though we're in this ridiculous moment nationally. But that work is still happens, right, and still has an impact. And I think that there is a lot more openness and willingness and opportunity for folks who are ready to say, yeah, no, this isn't right. Like, I'm actually not safer. In Alameda County, it's something like 375,000 people have records. That's like the size of our city, right? I'm not safer knowing that that amount of people are locked out of good jobs. That's not going to do anything good for public safety because people got to eat. And they're going to figure out a way one way or the other, right? So people are starting to be like, yeah, this, like, setting people up for failure in this way is not okay. And I feel like there are a lot more organizations, again, who primarily maybe aren't abolitionists, you know, don't come from that lens, but are starting to say, yeah, this is too much. This is crazy. We've got to do something. We've got to roll this out.
Maybe a couple to extend the question out or to the other things that I think sometimes there's a weird distinction that's being made if this is a labor issue as opposed to an issue that's a different one, but as if it's not affecting the entire working class community. And so I'm thinking about these struggles that are coming out in particular black working class communities against imprisonment or for education. I guess all these things are interconnected. These are working class struggles. So, here's one to speak to that.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about the security guards in L.A., which at one point were the majority of the workers were black workers, and these were also union, well-paying jobs that, you know, over time, you know, as the 3Ds kind of came through, they started, you know, companies started doing this thing called double-breasting, where you would have a union contract, and then you would have a non-union contract that would underbid a lot of the union contracts. And slowly, the unionization level fell, and with it, so did the participation of black workers. And then you got like an exploitable workforce, which was immigrants, you know, who were coming into LA at the time. And I see a version of that happening again today with the gig economy. So you, if you take like the public sector jobs that you were talking about, like the postal service, and you get these like competing Amazon delivery drop-offs within 2 hours, non-union, horrible, no benefits, coming and starting to replace these secure jobs gone. And you see, like, I just went to this conference and, you know, the metro bus system is trying to get, like, these Uber-like buses that can supplement some of their, you know, their gaps. And again, you know, is the public sector coming in and, you know, basically in their public-private partnerships, destabilizing good union jobs, you know, benefit jobs, quality jobs, things like that. And to me, like, that's the next thing that we're worried about is how can we be pushing our public agencies to stop doing that or to hold these like, parallel two-tiered systems with worse jobs as more accountable and not lowering the floor, which is what's happening. I think that's just
one
another additional point I wanted to make.
You know, I was curious. I sent this quote to you all a few days ago, and it was this statistic about, you know, the more likely a labor struggle that has women of color leadership and it is more likely to win. This is from a few days ago. Hopefully that's the truth. I'm curious, I think that there's some sort of mythology that happens, particularly around the Trump movement, when they talk about the working class and it automatically means white men and things like this. I think inversely, when we talk about struggles around the barriers to employment or to a good life and imprisonment in general, it often stops at men as well, and it's black men. I'm curious, some of the work that you've talk about the leadership of black women in fighting against these barriers and for things like down the block and so on. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of things. For some reason my brain is just kind of fixated on the lack of connections that are being made. Because in the research setting where I was, it was very much, kind of service organizations helping people with the direct task of trying to get hired, which is very different from the organizing setting led by black women that I have been a part of. I think there's a significant amount of disconnect going on, at least in terms of this issue, between the legal struggles. A lot of the kind of work around this is either through policy or through trying to use the little bits of law to protect people. And I think, the strongest moments have happened when those things come together. But they definitely don't always. So that it's kind of like the lawyers are doing their thing, and then the formerly incarcerated organizers are doing their thing, and then there's like the masses of people who are just trying to survive and do their thing, and there's not always a lot of connection between all of those things. But I think what the difference that it makes, what happens when women of color or just former prisoners, when you have a leadership voice that's not just about policy and not just about legal reform, then that's when we get the chance to take this issue much further and to, it was in those kind of early days of Ban the Box before it was just a policy thing that people were doing without the leadership of former prisoners, when former prisoners and particularly formerly incarcerated black women were leading it, that's when we were using those forums to talk, to challenge the relevance of criminal records, to suggest that maybe this actually isn't relevant to my candidacy for this job, to question what the criminal record even means, like to kind of unpack some of that, those really taken for granted ideas now that, the criminal record means that you did this bad thing, as opposed to, it's actually just a record of whose actions have been criminalized, as opposed to who's done what, and I think that those, if you kind of, you get into these other kinds of conversations when you leave the organizing out of the picture, and we're just left with kind of trying to take the criminal record at face value as if it's some sort of neutral indication of the good people and the bad people, as opposed to what we all know that it is.
There's no question in my mind that we have to follow our people, right? And but I think what is sometimes hard is just the capacity of groups to do that. So number one, I'm not ready to see Oakland, but I understand that Pittsburgh and Antioch are where my people are right now. So my whole church, like in West Oakland, practically the whole church lives in Pittsburgh and Antioch, and they all come in for church, right? At some point, I'm going to be really upset if they move the church to Pittsburgh, because I'm trying to go to Pittsburgh. But my point being, we need to follow our people and figure out how to build stuff where people build, because as much as people will drive in for stuff that's important to them, it just gets overwhelming after a while. You've got the kids, you've got this, you've got to get people to school. You can't come to an evening meeting down in Oakland if you're not in Oakland anymore, right? So that's just real, and I think it's a new thing that many organizations, I see EVs in the room, we all are talking now. Folks are trying to figure out how to move, right? So that's one thing. It just sometimes can be hard to figure out how to manage and not give up on, you're not trying to give up on your other things, right? And then to the gentleman's point in the back, we are a black organizing space as an organization, but our campaigns are multiracial and our coalitions are multiracial, and there's no way we could have done the 1400 job campaign in Alameda County without having a multiracial alliance. And that's very important to us, and creating spaces
of that, and I would just add that as we build these alliances, I think there's a way that this work often happens in a very colorblind and conviction-blind kind of way, and I guess that's what I was trying to emphasize earlier, like the idea that if we just do something positive for people with criminal records, that the benefits will just trickle down to everybody. I think we have to be conscious of that as we build the coalitions and know that they will disproportionately benefit white people with convictions and people with certain kinds of convictions that are more sympathetic than others. And so we need to deal with those particularities and not kind of continue to gloss over them.
Maybe the one thing I would say is, you know, the data I presented, I ran it again for California, and it was almost exactly the same. So much so that I didn't even have to change, like, half the tables and charts. And then if you look at it nationally, it was mirroring the same thing, and it's the same year after year. It's not like suddenly one year, you know, there was all this disparity. And so to me, it shows that there's a normalizing that's happened about racism, you know, and racism towards black people. And when I think of, like, all the sexual harassment and Me Too and stuff like that, which are also decades-old stories, is that people are finally saying no. Like, we're not going to be complicit. We're not going to let it go. We're going to call it out, and we're going to make people lose their jobs, and we're going to make people lose their companies over it. And I feel like that does require all of us to stand up. And so what would that look like for discrimination? Like, we're not going to do this. We're not going to stand by and see racism implicit or institutionalized or, you know, just the things that we let go, because that's just the way of business. And